Alright guys, welcome to our preview and predictions for WWE Hell in a Cell, which takes place this Sunday live on the WWE Network, which is actually sponsored by none other than WWE 2K16. So we're just a few days away from the release of the game. Elle, are you getting excited?
I really can't wait, like, compared to last year. Like, I'm beyond excited. I'm in hype mode. Forget brain mode, it's hype mode.
It's like it's Christmas coming up, isn't it?
It really is. I can't remember the last time I was so excited for, like, a wrestling game.
And there's, like, so much, like, in this one as well. So many updates and upgrades, my career and everything. I just can't wait to jump straight into it and just sit down and play it. Never mind putting out videos. I just want to play the game this year.
Yeah, I just want to, like, binge play it and, like, not sleep and eat for weeks and just play on it.
That's how we're all going to be next week. We'll be absolutely knackered by the end of the week. So what are you got in store for people next week?
Well, for the first week, I'm going to do a lot of Divas Korean mod because the people seem to enjoy that. And then I want to try this new breakout feature. I want to, like, kick some array off the top turnbuckle and things and just see what fun things we can do.
Oh, man, there's so many, like, cool things you can do with the breakout. I think you'll have loads of fun with that. Are you going to, like, jump in to create Diva as well so you can, like, put in PCB in people?
Oh, definitely. I think that's going to be, like, one of the very first things I do. So no doubt I'll record that and put that out within the first day.
That'll be something you'll definitely have to do. I think that's everything what people are looking for. Because, like, when I asked what people want to see in the first community showcase, everything was Sasha Banks, Bayley, Charlotte. So everyone's really looking forward to them. So I think when the game releases, I'm going to kind of jump in, do some community showcases. Because we've got quite a lot of guys and girls that aren't actually on the roster that are in the WWE now. So I think I'll try and hit that first. I'm going to try and do career mode as well this year. And then I'll probably do universe mode a little bit later on. I think you're doing universe as well.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to do universe. I think I'm going to wait a little bit first because I, like, have an appearance and something coming up. So I think I'm going to lead on from that.
That sounds interesting. We'll have to wait and see what that is.
Spoilers.
So there you go. That is our plans for this game in the next couple of weeks. So make sure to subscribe to both of our channels so you don't miss out on any of the action. Now, before we get to Hell in a Cell, let's take a look back at last month's predictions, because we had Night of Champions, and that was topped by none other than Tom Rise Rules, Chicken Boxer 44 for the second month in a row, and Breakdown. So they all scored a perfect 8 out of 8 correct results. So congratulations to you guys on those perfect scores. As for me and you, Elle, how do you think we fared?
I think I won. I hope I won.
You always think you won.
I'm usually right, though.
Sorry to drag you back, but you scored 6. I scored 6 as well. So it was a draw?
No, ladies first, so, like, I win.
I'm sure that's not how it works. I think we did pretty well, though. 6 out of 8, that's a pretty good score.
Oh, definitely. It feels like such a long time since the last pay-per-view.
It seems like ages ago. It's been, like, so long. There must have been, like, 5 weeks or so since the last pay-per-view.
It's crazy, like, to think, like, only a few months ago we had one, like, every 2 weeks.
I know, like, I was getting used to, like, a pay-per-view every week and then, like, NXT and things as well. So there's been so much in the past, and now it seems like we've really been made to wait for it. And I don't know if it's really benefited because of that. I kind of preferred it when they were, like, coming quick, like, every other week. The storylines just seem to, like, flow a lot better, whereas now they seem to really be dragged out.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of this card's, like, something we've seen for the past few months, whereas when we had, like, the pay-per-views all together, we had, like, a few mix-up and things, but now, I don't know, a lot of it needs refreshing, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think this is, like, there seems to be a theme on this when I was looking at the match card, and I think a lot of these matches will be the end of certain feuds. So I think, looking forward, we can kind of get some new people in there. I think it'll probably freshen things up a little bit. So if you want to get involved and you want to submit your predictions, then you can head over at smacktalks.org/predictions, submit yours for the show, and you can go head-to-head with us. So let's head on to the pre-show for the match, for the show. We've got Dolph Ziggler teaming with Cesaro and Neville to take on the team of Rusev, Sheamus, and King Barrett. So how do you see this one going? It's kind of been thrown together at the last minute.
Yeah, it's, like, a really hard one to predict because it's not anything that's been going on for so long. It's, like, it's really mixed up. I think I'm going to go with the faces, possibly.
I think that's probably what I was thinking with this one. I think it's one that I think, really, it could go anywhere. But the way I see it is they've kind of thrown this together to maybe bring an end to some of these rivalries. Because we've had, like, Ziggler and Rusev going on forever. And the storyline's just got worse and worse to the point that they've abandoned it, like, because of the engagement to Lana. So I think this will be a way that this kind of ends. And I think some of these like opponents in here, I'll probably either switch to a package kind of going forward with someone else from it. So it kind of switches around a little bit. But I think this will be the last time we see Ziggler and Rusev for quite a while.
Yeah, after this week's SmackDown, I think there's a possibility that Dolph will go on to have like a little feud with Tyler Breeze, so maybe he'll get involved.
Yeah, actually, that is like something that I was looking forward to. When I seen like SmackDown this week and I seen that, I think that's a good pairing to have them go up against each other. So I'm looking forward to seeing how that goes. As for like the other people in the match, I was surprised Stardust wasn't in this because I thought this might be in like the end of his and Neville's feud. But Neville's kind of switched the focus over to King Barrett, and Sheamus has also sort of been involved. And then we've got Cesaro on the other team. So hopefully, like, all these guys going up together, this kind of brings some closure to that, and we can get them sort of with different people going forward.
Yeah, I think it's crazy. It's a shame, mainly, because that group of people, they're, like, the future of the WWE, and there's some strong contenders, but not one of them are in, like, a high-profile feud, so it's a bit of a shame.
Yeah, I think so. I think, like, going forward, like, I could see these going on to better things. I think at the minute, they've just all been kind of held up in this kind of stuck in a rut, I guess you could say, like, all together, and they haven't really gone anywhere. So I think by the time they freshen things up next month, it'll move on to better things. And I can see, like, maybe one of them going up for the next match we're going to talk about, which is the Continental Championship. So the next match on the card, we're both going for Dolph Ziggler, Cesaro, and Neville in that first one, I think. Did we agree on that?
Yeah, definitely.
So as we move on to the Continental Championship, we see Kevin Owens defending the title against Ryback. So he gets his rematch for the match that we've seen at Night of Champions. How do you see this one going? Do you think it'll be a decent match? Because it wasn't too bad last time, was it?
The match itself wasn't too bad. It wasn't anything memorable, but just this bloody feud. Like, we're having, like, back and forth Twitter action where, quite frankly, Kevin Owens is ripping Ryback, but it's like, oh my God, give us something new.
Well, I think that is what we're going to get after this as well. We just mentioned sort of people moving on past as new. And I think Neville is someone that I could really see going into this Intercontinental Championship battle and maybe going up against Kevin Owens. I think they would have an awesome match. I think that would be something that I would love to see. But the problem with Ryback and Owens puts on like all these amazing wrestler matches, all these crazy moves from the top rope. And the reason that it's kind of struggled for me with Ryback is he cannot really do the same kind of thing with Ryback because of the size of him. So it's a completely different kind of match that we're seeing. And because of that, I haven't really got into it too much. But I will say, like, credit Ryback. He has come on quite a bit from where he was. Although, like, I just want to see him kind of pushed aside and bring someone else into this. As for, like, how it turns out, I think it'll be very similar to last month. I think because Ryback's the bigger, stronger guy, then we'll see Owens kind of use his veteran heel tactics, and he'll do something to kind of get the win, but not a clean win. It'll be something like last time where he sort of pulled at the face of Ryback to get out the shell shock and then hit him like with his finisher. So I could see the same kind of thing happening this time. So I think in terms of predictions, I'm going to go Owens via heel tactics.
I'm definitely going to agree with Owens, but I kind of think he needs to win clean just so he can get this feud out of the way. And I definitely think someone like Neville should go up against him and have like a David versus Goliath feud. And it definitely showcases both of them because I kind of feel for all he's got the title, Owens has been like a bit underutilized and he's not really been able to show off like he used to.
Yeah, it hasn't really like stood up to expectations, I don't think. I think if he does go up with someone against Neville, like, Owens is capable of all these amazing moves, but like I just said, Ryback, he can't really take those kind of moves. Whereas someone like Neville, not only can he take like the moves from the top rope, but the way he sells them is absolutely crazy. So I think we could be like in for a right treat if we get the two of them.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I just hope to God that this Sunday it is the end of Kevin Owens and Ryback, because God knows I can't take another feud between them.
Yeah, I hope they move on. So we're going with the same prediction on this one as well. Going to go Owens?
Yeah.
Cool. There's two out of two. Next match, I think this will probably take place quite early in the card. So we've got Hell in a Cell number one, as we've got Roman Reigns and Bray Wyatt. So these two have been doing battle again for months and months, like a lot of these feuds. So it all started out back at Money in the Bank when Bray Wyatt actually cost Roman Reigns the victory. And from there, he's gone with the line of anyone but you, Roman. And it's led to some decent matches between the two. I think they had a really good main event on Raw. And that really like showcased what the two of them could do. And then from there, we've seen things like the reunion of the Y family and even the new addition of the giant that is Braun Strowman. So I think the Wyatts now, they're in a much better position than they were, because they'd really kind of faded away. But with Strowman's addition, it's brought them back to the forefront, of the WWE, and they're more of a powerful force again. So I really want to see them kind of continue that and get the win here. But because this has been like a feud that's been going on for so long, I think the only way you can kind of draw a line under it and end it is if Reigns finally like gets the better of Wyatt. So I think prediction-wise, I'm probably going to go with Reigns on this one, although I would prefer to see the Wyatts win it.
I don't know, I kind of disagree. I can see Roman winning because I think WWE, for whatever reason, they're really hung up on Roman and they want to make him this huge star. But I kind of think Bray and the Wyatt family are doing like amazing things, and I'm really loving them, especially Braun. It's like a totally new dynamic for something that's, it didn't get stale, but it was kind of lost.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm loving it, and I think they need the win to go forward and pick someone else.
Well, that's the thing. I think they do need the win. I don't think Roman Reigns does. But at the same time, I think it's all about sort of overcoming your demons, I guess, like underlying theme of it. So that's that's why I could like see Reigns win it. How do you think it'll play out, though? Because it's a Hell in a Cell match, and it's basically being booked so that the rest of the family can get in. And then we've got other people on the other side, like Dean Ambrose, Randy Orton. We've even had Chris Jericho in this last month. But I see, like, some of these elements, like Ambrose, the Wyatts, I see them all getting involved in this. They'll still find a way in. Do you think we'll see the rest of them get involved?
Yeah, I kind of think it's a shame that they brought Eric Rowan's back so soon, like on the Monday, and the whole way they did that was kind of weird. It was like he'd never gone.
Well, I was watching Raw, and I seen the Wyatt family match, and I seen Eric Rowan on the apron, and I was looking at him, and I didn't register the fact he was back. And then all of a sudden, like, they mentioned Eric Rowan. I was like, hang on, that's Eric Rowan. He's returned. Where's Luke Harper? And it was, like, so underwhelming. Like, the commentary team didn't really, like, make a big deal of it or anything. Where if they'd kept it to Hell in a Cell, he could have been a surprise return. And I think that would have worked probably better.
It would have been interesting as well, because you may not have necessarily known whose side he was on. They could have done something where the lights go out and both of them are on the floor or whatever, and then it's like, well, who helped who, and who's going to get in trouble? So I kind of think there was an opportunity doing that underhanded move on Raw, but...
Yeah, it was kind of strange. I think I would have preferred them to keep that for Hell in a Cell. But like I say, I think there'll definitely be a point where sort of maybe all of them kind of get in the cell, and it's just like a bit of an all-out war. Because we've seen like people get in the cell loads of times over the years. And I think with the strength of Braun Strowman, what I can really see is him coming down to ringside kind of reminiscent of Kane when he debuted and just ripping the door off.
It's funny because I was literally just thinking that I can imagine Braun coming down and just wasting them all to hell, basically.
Hmm.
And yeah, like you said, I think he's like the modern day Kane, like the Terror Force.
He's unstoppable at the minute. We've had like so many people going up against him and they've all been choked out. So it kind of begs the question, who is going to stop him?
Hopefully no one, but it'll probably be Cena. You know, like how WWE like to do that.
That could be a good shout, because we've got the Open Challenge match later on, which we're going to talk about. So I think we could actually see him maybe rock up in that match. I think it'd be a good challenge for Cena.
I think it'd be one hell of a challenge, and I don't think Cena would necessarily possibly walk out. If it was someone like Braun, I think he's probably got the biggest chance if someone was to beat him.
Yeah, it would be a good way of getting the title off Cena when you've like booked Braun Strowman as like such a monster going into this. So I think that would be like quite a good way to go about this. But kind of before we get to that, what are you going to go prediction-wise? Do you still think the Wyatts should win? Do you think they will win? Or...
Yeah, I kind of think this is like the rebirth of the Wyatts, and they need this win to go on and do bigger and better things.
I totally agree with that, but I'm going to go the opposite. So like, I just think like so hung up on Roman Reigns, and I think to kind of get over this, he has to get the win. So I think we're going to have to see like differently on this one. So I'm going to go with Reigns, you go with Wyatt. And then that leads me into the next match, which is for the WWE Divas Championship. Charlotte defends against the longest reigning Divas Champion in history. How good does it sound to say that? So we've got Nikki Bella. How do you see this one going?
I kind of think it's a bit obvious. I think Charlotte's going to win, and I think she has to win if they want to establish her as this genetic superior and her doing things not in her father's name but in her own name.
Yeah, I think so. I think this is Charlotte's time. So I think she needs a strong victory here. She needs to get a clean victory. Although, to be fair, I can see like a lot of people at ringside for this and kind of getting involved in this. But I think if Charlotte wins here and she dispatches Nikki, it gives her the chance to then go for like quite a lengthy run that really like cements her sort of legacy as the Divas champion. And I think moving forward, it gives them a chance to then, you know, get Nikki's rematch out of the way and bring in someone else. So I could really see like Sasha coming in for that Divas Championship match. And then hopefully with like them being two NXT women, it gives her that NXT women's type match as opposed to a Divas match. And that would be something that I'm really looking forward to, kind of that direction.
Yeah, for all that, I kind of want Charlotte to win clean and cement like her Divas Championship reign, especially beating the longest reign. I think we're going to get some more play on this Who Attacked Natalya thing. I know Paige listed like a few former Divas and things, and there's been like a talk of some people returning and whatnot. So I think we're going to kind of get another thing of that. Maybe Becky or someone's going to get knocked out, or maybe even someone from Team Bella. And I kind of think that might come into play.
That'd be quite cool, actually, if like someone like does knock out someone like Becky backstage, and it's like, what's going on here? And like, everyone is going to be expecting it to be Paige. I'm pretty sure it's going to be Paige anyway. I'm sure they'll go with a simple option. Do you think it's Paige? Is Paige behind it?
She probably is at the minute, but WWE have done this probably about two times in the past year or so. There was the whole thing with the Oksana, and then Layla was with AJ Lee and things. So they're probably writing it for Paige right now, but then they'll do a massive swerve and it'll be someone silly.
What do you make of like the way that Paige is being booked at the minute? Because once you had that Paige bomb, I thought she would like go ultimate heel, and I thought that'd really suit her. But the
Yeah.
next week on Raw, she kind of backtracked on that, and then when she was asked if she was still with PCB, she said she was, and she was kind of floating in between it, and we don't really know where she is now. She's got the stuff with Natalya. Do you see her sort of having separate matches with Natalya going forward? Or do you think she'll get herself involved in this title picture?
Well, I loved her pipe bomb, and I thought, oh, great, she's going to go back to being like on her own and she can focus more on wrestling and get rid of some of these tag matches. But then I liked how Natalya came in, so. But she is kind of lost in the shuffle, and somehow it's become more about Paige than it has about the championship, which is a shame. But at the same time, at least everyone else is getting used as well.
Yeah, it's good to see them kind of focusing on everyone. I think Becky's still one person I think is getting lost in it. I would love to see her like get a bit more of an opportunity, but I think further down the line, that's probably something that we'll see a bit later on.
Yeah, I wouldn't wholeheartedly be like surprised if it turns out that it was Becky.
That would be a cool way to go about it, actually, if like Becky is sort of siding with Paige and then maybe turn on Charlotte.
It'd definitely be interesting. It'd shake things up a bit, and then Charlotte can focus on being the Divas champion.
That would be a cool way to go about it. So I think again with this one, we're seeing eye to eye on this. So
Yeah.
surely it's going to be a win for Charlotte.
Hopefully. Fingers crossed, because God knows we don't need another Nikki Bella run.
Absolutely. That just thinking of that, like it's got to be Charlotte. I'll be right, and if not, so that takes us into the WWE Tag Team Championship match. We've got the New Day taking on the Dudley Boys. So the Dudleys are again out to try and get this 10th title that's been eluding them, but the New Day, they're still on such a good roll, and the best thing going in WWE is so entertaining. It's the best every single week, and I'm so glad that they're not limiting them to like the tag division. They've put them in like the main event and things, and like all throughout the show, they keep going back to them, and I absolutely love it. It's like I always complain when we say like Seth and Kane throughout the show, and there's like too many segments with them, but you could just give us like 3 hours of the New Day, and I would be absolutely happy with it.
I'm still really, really high on the New Day. I'm just not high on this feud. I think they probably brought the Dudleys in too high when they've come back. I think maybe they should have earned the title opportunity, because now the Dudleys are kind of stuck in a rut, because I don't think New Day should lose the titles. But it's then, where did the Dudleys go if they do lose again?
Yeah, that's the strange thing about this. Like, I feel they've pushed them straight into it, and I thought they would have built them up to like take them on. But then again, the like Dudleys are like, it's kind of like a legend coming back because they are two
Yeah.
legends of the tag division, so they kind of deserve that shot at the title. But at the same time, I really don't think it's like makes any sense to drop the titles for the New Day at the minute and give it the Dudleys. I think they should hold on them for a little bit longer. And when I was looking at like the pay-per-view cards coming up, then we've got Survivor Series next month. So that gives them a chance to maybe do something with like the three of the New Day against the Dudleys. So that they could maybe find a partner, maybe like bring back Spike. And then the following month after that, we've got TLC. So I think that would be a really cool match to have, a TLC match with the Dudley Boys and the New Day. Because the Dudley Boys were like one of the first teams that actually invented TLC with the Hardys and Edge and Christian. So it'd be kind of fitting if they had that TLC match and they'd win the titles then. Or even just a tables match with it being TLC. So I think maybe hold off till then and just give the New Day the win in this one and prolong their tag reign. Because the first reign they had was quite short.
Yeah, I'd definitely love to see them in like a TLC match with the New Day. My only thing is it's prolonging that because we have Survivor Series next.
Mm-hmm.
So that means having New Day, maybe, because Davey Woods has been in through the table a few times, so he'll be dead by the time it gets to like TLC.
He's so used to it now. You can just push it off.
I don't think they should lose and then win it. But it's a confusing one. I don't think there's a winning situation because if the Dudleys win, it kind of kills off New Day a little. But if New Day win, it kind of makes the Dudleys look weak again.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind like kind of fudgy finishing it where it gets like a DQ or something like that. But I was trying to think, did that happen at the Madison Square Garden event? Was that a DQ finish?
Yeah, it happened twice now. Xavier Woods has like come in and like kicked whoever was pinning who.
So that kind of makes us think that this time we won't see that. We'll probably see like someone actually get the win. I don't know. I really want to see the New Day win it. So I'm probably going to stick with the New Day just because of the fact that I enjoy them so much. So I think something will happen where it's not clear cut. Like there isn't a clean finish. And I can see Woods definitely getting involved. But at the same time, I don't know. I don't think the Dudleys should win it just yet. Not when they're only just coming back.
I honestly can't decide because like I really, really want New Day to win. But like you say, it's the Dudleys. It's giving them like a backhand sort of thing because they've basically lost every pay-per-view. I think I have to go with the New Day just purely because they're amazing.
I can't argue with that reason. That's a good reason as far as I'm concerned. So I think, again, like we'll see eye-to-eye on this one. It's got to be the New Day, hopefully.
I thought you were going to do like a New Day chant or something there.
I'll save that for like Sunday. I'll make sure I start it. So that takes me into like the open challenge for the United States Championship. So we don't know who John Cena is going to be taking on. We've got a few suggestions. WWE.com had a poll up earlier. And some of the people that they mentioned in there, we've got people like Tyler Breeze, who made his debut on SmackDown. We've got Samoa Joe, Hideo Itami, Sami Zayn. I thought maybe legend-wise, Daniel Bryan, could he return?
See, I think Daniel Bryan would be like a really good one because nobody's really forgotten, but like we're not expecting it, so it'd be like a huge pop.
It would be like, it's something that when there is an open challenge like this and it's on a pay-per-view, you're expecting it to be like a really big name. Whereas a lot of the other people, I kind of see them rocking up on Raw, but maybe it not being as big a deal. And like with Bryan, we've been told that he has been cleared by regular doctors for a while now. It's just the WWE doctors that haven't cleared him. So I think there is a chance it could be Bryan. And I would love it if it was. But what do you think about Braun Strowman, what we mentioned earlier? Would you prefer to see him come up?
I think I would prefer to see that. I think I'd save Bryan for like a bigger pay-per-view because Hell in a Cell's really not that important, really. They've tried to make it into something big, but they never really do anything that's like, wow. Yeah. So I think for me, I'd save it for one of like the big four, like Survivor Series or something like that.
Yeah, I kind of agree with that. Like the thing I would say though is like we had the match on sort of our card here in terms of whereabouts it is for Roman Reigns and Bray Wyatt. So even if Reigns wins, it'd be good for the Wyatt family to have Strowman go out and maybe take the title from Cena and really send a message again, like saying how powerful the Wyatts are. But at the same time, we've seen Bray Wyatt against John Cena in the past. And that's kind of the thing that makes us think maybe we won't get this.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to get it just yet. For all I love it, I don't think it'd make like a great deal of sense, especially with Bray Wyatt having this feud with Roman Reigns. I think we're going to get someone, say like Heath Slater or someone, you know, like who's been pushing for it.
We can't get Heath Slater on a pay-per-view. That'd be such a waste.
Well, he keeps missing out. Like, he goes to go out and someone else takes his spot. So it's about time he got out there. You never know, he might even win.
I don't know. I think that's out there as far as predictions go. I think maybe Sami Zayn. I think the first match he had with Cena, it was supposed to be like his main Raw debut, and he got injured during his entrance, which was really unlucky. But he still managed to put on such an awesome match with Cena. I think if he's close to returning, then this could be the perfect opportunity to do it and actually get a pay-per-view match. And, you know, after seeing how amazing that match was, seeing Cena and Sami Zayn where he's not injured and he can go like 100%, I think being for an absolutely amazing match.
I definitely love to see that again, especially after the first time. But talking about returning, there's a few rumours going around that a certain former world heavyweight champion might be coming back.
There is? Who's this?
Alberto.
No, don't say that.
I personally can't stand him. He bars me, but if he is going to come back, I think it'd be a good way to interject some, like, remembering or whatever.
I guess it'd be kind of cool when you see, like, someone return like that. It gets, like, initial pop. But then when you realise it's Alberto Del Rio, it doesn't have that same effect. I think he was someone that just, I don't know, he had quite a lot of, like, world title reigns. And it never seemed to, like, do much for me. I never really got too interested in it. I always found him quite boring.
Yeah, he definitely barred me, hence Alberto.
Well, I think I'd prefer to see him, like, stay in his Triple A. I think he was wrestling in something like that in Mexico, so I would prefer him to stay over there. I don't really know if I want him back in WWE.
Yeah, he can stay away.
So what do you think we should do prediction wise for this? Do you think we should say, is John Cena going to win, or is the person he faces going to win? Do you see Cena losing? Because this is on a pay-per-view, so there is a chance of it. Then again, it is John Cena.
Unless it's someone major, I don't think Cena's going to lose. There's no reason for him to lose just yet.
I don't know. I'm kind of like on the fence with this one. I think because it's a pay-per-view, it gives you that kind of thought. This is a pay-per-view. It's not TV. There is a chance he could lose and the title will change hands. But at the same time, not knowing who it is, I think it's kind of hard to put a prediction out there. So I think we'll skip this one prediction-wise. But I think we'll probably end up seeing Cena retain anyway.
So do you predict that it's going to be Braun that's going to turn up?
I'm probably going to go Sami Zayn.
I think I'm going to go with Tyler Breeze. It'd be a good way, especially after SmackDown, to have his very first like pay-per-view match for them.
Breeze would be awesome. I'd be really happy with that. I think that's a good choice.
Yeah, I definitely think it'd be a good way to like introduce him to people who haven't watched NXT as well.
It is, like, doing that on pay-per-view, I think that's ideal. So, like you say, like, Tyler Breeze, I think that'd be an awesome option. Mm-hmm. So, that takes us into the next match, which is, really, it's generally the main event. We've got the championship on the line. So, it's the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. We've got Seth Rollins defending against the Demon Kane. And if the Demon loses, then Corporate Kane will be fired as Director of Operations. So, what do you make of this one? Do you like how things have been going?
Like, I know, like, how everyone's moaning about Kane and things, but I'm bloody loving it. I think it's hilarious. And I'm loving, like, this bipolar side to Kane where he's like, oh, well, you've got to do this. And then Kane just randomly turns up and beats living crap out of Seth. And it's kind of made, like, Kane, for all it's comical, it's not the usual, like, anger therapy and things he went through. And, like, he's kicking the crap out of him. Uh-huh. So how could you not love it?
Well, that's the thing. Like, I see people complain about this all the time, about, oh, Kane's supposed to be a monster. He's got to go out there and destroy everyone. We kind of have this, like, comedy side. It just kills him. And then I see, like, people like Dolzinski just constantly complaining about it and saying, oh, bring back the original mask. That'll sort him out. And I'm like, you know, this isn't the best booking, but at the same time, I actually really find this funny. I really like Kane in this kind of position. I'll actually be sad if he gets fired as Director of Operations.
Yeah, me too. I can't see like him winning, unless obviously Sheamus cashes in. But I'm loving it. I love seeing both sides, and I don't want him to get rid of it just yet. I think it could go a little further.
Well, I didn't even think about like Sheamus cashing in, so maybe that could be an option. Like regardless of if Kane wins or not, but I don't know. I think Kane is someone that, yes, I've kind of warmed to him like with this comedy angle, but at the same time, I don't think if he could if he would win the championship at the current moment. I would love to see him get one last reign, but I don't know if he's the man to beat Seth.
He's not really championship material, especially the way he's going on lately, for me personally.
He doesn't really like come across as like your champion. Like, he's got the better of Seth at times, and I love the way that Seth gets really frustrated with him. So, like, I wouldn't mind it if he won. But at the same time, I think it's another kind of legendary name at the same time for Seth to beat and add the list of people that he's defeated. And I can kind of still see Seth keeping the title. I can't really see anyone that's going to take it away from him at the moment.
Yeah, the only other thing that I can think of, because it's been teased that Undertaker and Kane are going to maybe rejoin up again. Mm-hmm. So maybe we're going to get some, maybe Kane will interact in the Undertaker and Brock match, and maybe they'll help each other out.
See, that'd be interesting, though. I could see that happening, but it's with them like both being on the same card, and I think these matches will be close together. So I could see Kane helping the Undertaker win against Brock, but I don't know if I could see him also like showing up in the Seth Rollins match if he's got a match later in the night, because I think he's going to be like the main event.
Yeah, it's kind of like, it feels like it's an obvious outcome, but at the same time, I don't want to throw it under the bus.
Yeah, I get what you mean. I think there's the possibility that could happen. It's going to be interesting to see what way they go. I think the way it's been booked, like with the bipolar stuff and like split personality, then there is a chance that we'll get like some kind of weird finish. I just hope we don't get like a fake Kane or something, and we've got like corporate Kane at ringside as well. And it's like, that's not me. That really is a demon.
Yeah, maybe like Braun Strowman will be like the Kane like they did with years ago, and then we'll have corporate Kane like at ringside.
How weird would that be if you come out like with the mask and everything, and everyone thought that is Kane, and it turns out like corporate Kane comes down and says, "Ah, that's not me. That's not me, mate. That's a demon."
They should have made him the special guest ref.
That would have been amazing. Like, see if he turns up, just see who it is. That would have been really funny just to see what they do with it. So, I don't know. I think I'm probably going to stick with Seth. How do you see your prediction going?
Yeah, I think it has to be Seth. It'd be kind of a shame. I kind of think they're going to maybe challenge CM Punk's reign with Seth Rollins.
It's a good like point to bring up, because they've done it like with AJ Lee's reign, like erasing that. So I think Seth is, well, he's the golden boy, really. He's the hand-picked one. Everyone talks about Roman Reigns, but that is Seth Rollins at the minute. So I could definitely see them kind of keeping that title on him just to raise that and just get CM Punk out of there.
My only issue with that is obviously Sheamus has got Money in the Bank, and it kind of feels a shame if Sheamus isn't going to get the title.
It does, but at the same time, like, Sheamus has like had Money in the Bank before and cashed in and won.
Yeah, but then obviously Rollins can't overtake CM Punk.
Yeah, but what I mean is, like, if Sheamus has like cashed in before, I don't think he needs to cash in and win this time.
The only thing is that I think if Sheamus doesn't cash in and win, I think there's a good chance he could get lost and maybe be in that Randy Orton kind of category where he's just floating around doing this, that and the other.
I wouldn't really mind that too much at the minute. When he come back, I thought like he was ideal then. But I think I've seen too many matches with Randy Orton, and it just made us like so bored of Sheamus.
It's a shame because he was like really on fire. I still get hyped when I hear Sheamus's music, but they've kind of really booked him really bad since he did win Money in the Bank.
Yeah, it's been a strange book, and it's kind of like hurt him for me. I think that's why I've sort of lost a bit of interest in him. But I wouldn't mind the Sheamus reign. I could go with that if he cashed in. And it's a good way to like see it, you know, Seth didn't lose kind of cleanly if he's like had a match and he's been exhausted and then he's got cashed in on.
I think that's the only chance Kane might win. I think if Kane does win, he won't leave Hell in a Cell as champion. We'll have Sheamus come in.
Yeah, I could totally see that happening. I wouldn't be surprised if the authority sent him out there just to kind of get that off Kane, like stick with kind of Seth and the own guys. Because Kane seems to be put out there a little bit more. They've kind of moved away from him.
Yeah, and at least we'd still get corporate Kane.
Yeah, that's a good point. I would love to see that. It'll be like a really fun workplace with everyone there. Lots of like anonymous emails going around. So that kind of takes me into the last match. We're both going with Seth Rollins. So the final match on the card is the main event, and it is the Hell in a Cell match. The originator of the Hell in a Cell match is the Undertaker steps inside the Devil's Playground to take on Brock Lesnar in what's being billed as the third and final chapter in their rivalry. So both men are sitting on one victory each after Lesnar done the unthinkable, defeated the streak at WrestleMania, which we never thought was going to happen. And then Undertaker actually got some revenge because he cost Lesnar the World Championship shot. Well, the World Championship in his rematch against Seth Rollins when he looked to have that one. And then he followed that up by getting the win at SummerSlam using heel tactics. So they're both one for one. This is the final encounter. Who's going to win it?
I kind of think the Undertaker might. Well, I originally thought the Undertaker would win and go on to face Sting at WrestleMania, but now because Sting's injured, it's kind of up in the air.
Yeah.
It's
a strange one with Sting. We don't know what's happening with it. I don't think he's really cleared anything up about his injury. I think they're still waiting to see what that's like. And it's still a long time leading into WrestleMania, unless they ought to do that before. But I think it all kind of depends on Sting's health now.
I think the thing is, as well, it's probably just me, and most people probably won't agree. I don't think it really matters at this point, like, who wins. Somehow, for me personally, it's kind of my excitement for Brock versus Taker is kind of, like, diminished.
It has a little bit, hasn't it? It doesn't have that same feel. I think for me, it's the fact that we've got the Undertaker going up, but it kind of feels like an old man going up against Lesnar and not having much of a chance. I think that's kind of killed it, just the way that he kind of looks, and he doesn't look as though he's very healthy and stuff. He looks a lot slower. So it makes me think, you know, there's no possible way he can beat him. But I think you will.
I don't think that fudgy finish helped as well, where it was like, well, Undertaker's won, no, Brock's won.
Hmm.
That, I think that was like, for me, it was like, oh, right, okay, that's that.
Well, it was kind of weird. If the Undertaker was going to win it, I wanted to see him, like, actually win it clean. And they were both one-on-one, a clean finish. But at the same time, I get why they done it. Like, saying that the Undertaker is weak and he needs to, like, rely on that. And I think this is an Undertaker now where, you know, I think he said on Raw that, like, when a man's lost everything, then the scary thing is he's got nothing else left to lose. So he'll kind of go out at all costs to win this match, because it is sort of the last thing that he's got here. And I think we'll probably see a continuation of kind of heel Undertaker, where he uses all these tactics to try and win it. And it's not going to be like your clean, good guy Undertaker that you want to cheer for, although everyone will still be cheering for him, regardless of whether he's heel or face.
I love how he's kind of like teetering over to like the American Badass Undertaker. He's not quite there, but he's got those vibes where he's like, he's ready to knock the two shites out of Brock.
I totally agree. I think it's another like reason of why I think he should have returned is that, because I think he's got like more of a chance when he goes down that route. It'd be awesome if like the sort of rolling hit and he come out as like the like American Badass with his bike and everything, but I don't see that happening. I think he'll just kind of wrestle more in that style, even though he doesn't have that look. So I can kind of expect this to be just an all-out brawl this time. I think it'll be a better match than what we've seen at SummerSlam. But in regards to the finish, I really don't know. I think Undertaker probably needs it more than Brock.
Do you see Brock getting tombstoned on the top of the Hell in the Cell?
I don't know if Undertaker could make it up to the top of the cell. That'd be quite an accomplishment.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. Like, if he tries to climb it and then he can't and just falls and goes through the table. But it'd be unique, to say the least.
It would. I think that's the point then where he has to call it a day.
I think it's going to be like a lot slower compared to the other Hell in a Cell match, and I think it might be better off to have this one before the other one.
I think this has to be the main event. You've got Lesnar and Undertaker, and just for them names alone, I think it has to be the main event.
It should be, but it's then like, I kind of feel like the other match has limitations so that Brock and Taker can do the bigger things, but then it's, can they actually go through with them?
Yeah, I think the two matches will be completely different. I think everyone, whenever we get a Hell in a Cell match, everyone's like, oh, I hope they go on top of the cell. And I think with these two, it's going to be a case of Roman Reigns and Bray Wyatt. I think they'll be the ones that go up top. I think Undertaker, sort of his age, I don't think he'll find it as easy to do that. And Lesnar, obviously the size of him, then it's going to be more awkward for him. So I think in terms of the match itself, I think it'll probably stay inside the Hell in a Cell. But I think this will be like quite a brutal match. It might be something like the match that we've seen with The Undertaker and Triple H at WrestleMania inside Hell in a Cell. But that had like Shawn Michaels in there as an element, and that kind of helped it. Where this one, it's just relying on both men to kind of go out there and put on this like match, which I think will probably be quite a short match. I don't think it'll go on too long. But I think it'll be quite a slow match at the same time.
Yeah, I think it's going to be like kind of an all-out brawl. I definitely think we're going to see Undertaker taking a Suplex City, probably against like most of the sides of the cell.
That'd be really cool if he like suplexes him into the cell. Like, that'd be really interesting. That's a good way to actually break out of it as well.
Because especially having like something like Hell in a Cell, you need to utilize like surroundings and make it like a unique match.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I'm going to call this now. I actually just thought of it. But I can see Roman Reigns spearing Bray Wyatt through the cell to get them outside.
Yeah, I definitely think we're going to get something like that. I dare say that those will be the ones to go through the cell or have like a spot on top of the cell.
Yeah, I totally think so. I think this will be like contained within it. And like sort of looking at history, this isn't the first time that these two have had a Hell in a Cell match. Because they had one back in 2002 at No Mercy, and Lesnar actually come out on top of that. So he's got the victory over the Undertaker in Hell in a Cell, and that's another reason I think Taker might win this. Also, this is Undertaker's 13th Hell in a Cell match, and he's currently tied at 6 wins and 6 losses. So being the originator of the match, I kind of want to see him win it, just so he's got like a better win-loss record. And with Lesnar already having a win over him in Hell in a Cell, I think he's due the win.
Like, when you look at those statistics, they are really, like, amazing statistics, and it kind of feels like the odds are stacked against Undertaker, but I definitely kind of like how we mentioned the Dudleys originated the TLC match. Mm. I kind of think for the same reason the Undertaker probably should win.
Yeah, I think so. I think it'll be a really good way. And, like, if Undertaker wins this, then there's a lot of rumours saying that he might be sticking around for a little bit longer this time. So if he does... If he wins this against Lesnar, I think that puts him in sort of line for another chance at the World Heavyweight Championship. So that would be really cool to get Undertaker actually in there and maybe get one final run leading into WrestleMania. And who knows, if Kane wins, we could even see Undertaker and Kane for the WWE Championship.
I'd love that personally. I think if Undertaker wins, he's got like a lot, not a lot more mileage, but I think there's a lot more you could do with Undertaker as opposed to Brock winning, because I'm not quite sure where Brock would go.
Well, that's the thing. I think if Brock wins, it's a case of he can go into that title picture, and that's all he can really do, because it's like going up from where he's at. Anything else, it's kind of downgrading him. Whereas Undertaker, I think if he wins it, If he does want to stick around and he's able to do that, it's the perfect opportunity to kind of give him that chance at the championship in one last run and make the most out of him. Because if we leave it longer and longer, he's getting older and older and he's going to find it harder. So I think if he feels okay, then this is the best time to do that and just have him maybe go for that one last run that I think we all want to see. And maybe culminate that with a match at WrestleMania, where I would love to see him go out against Kane in a final match, maybe for both of them, with them both kind of signing out. Or, obviously, there's the choice of Sting. But I think between the two, Sting and Kane, I would prefer to see Undertaker against Kane in a match that's maybe the last match for both of them guys.
I definitely think we're seeing the end of the days for people like Undertaker and Kane, possibly Big Show and like Randy Orton. I kind of think the days are numbered. There's like a new fresh load of talent who I don't think you could benefit having a match with. For all, it'd be iconic having a match with Undertaker. I don't think you could really garnish anything from anything like that anymore.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think it's really cool seeing all this talent come in. It's kind of like changing of the guard. But then when you've got the matches against The Undertaker, it'd be cool to give The Undertaker one more win. Like if you went up against someone new, like a Tyler Breeze. But at the same time, you don't see Tyler Breeze winning it, because it further devalues The Undertaker's WrestleMania streak. And if Undertaker wins it, it's like... Well, he's beat Tyler Breeze. Surely that's not going to be his last match. He must be coming back next year. And it just keeps you stuck in that rut of, you know, every year he's got to have a WrestleMania match.
Yeah.
And I would prefer to see him get a title run, which means a lot more leading into that and make that the final match.
And so, I definitely think he's deserving of picking the title one more time before he does retire.
Absolutely. I always said, like, if he wins it and he has like a decent run, his final match should be at WrestleMania, defend the title, and then he should just leave it in the ring and kind of retire. It'll be a good way to go out, and he's like undefeated, like as a final run. I think that'd be really cool. So I think in terms of predictions, I'm gonna go Undertaker on this, even though the odds seem to be stacked against him.
Yeah, I've been going backwards and forwards in my mind, but I think I'm gonna have to agree Undertaker. I think he'll get a lot more out of it by winning.
Absolutely. So that brings us to the end of our preview and predictions for WWE Hell in a Cell. But make sure to get involved and let us know your thoughts in the comments. And also check out the description for details on how you can win a special WWE 2K16 Stone Cold Steve Austin shirt, courtesy of 2K UK. Finally, before we sign out, we've also started a brand new project on a joint YouTube channel called Regeneration X, in which we bring you all kinds of geeky goodness from Doctor Who to various other video games and playthroughs. So make sure to check out the link in the chat in the video description for that channel. El, do you want to let people know what they can kind of expect from the new channel?
We've got some Minecraft stuff on there. I know we're going to do Star Wars Battlefront. Assassin's Creed Syndicate's just come out, and I'm going to be covering that over the next few weeks before WWE is out. So we're going to see like a lot more varied content, something some people have asked us about over the time. So it'll be interesting to see what people make of it.
Yeah, it should be really cool. I think people should definitely check that out. It gives them something other than sort of the wrestling content that we'll bring on with main channels. So that'll be quite cool. Also, leading into Halloween, I'm going to try and get together a top 5 scary games of 2015 and maybe play some scary games as well. I think that'll kind of tie in pretty well with Halloween. So as long as I don't get too scared and I don't squeal a little too much, then maybe I can upload them next week. And I don't know, are you going to do anything like that?
I'm thinking about playing some classic horror games, something a little different, because I know you were thinking about playing some more like up-to-date ones.
Yeah.
So I think it'd be a good clash to have like some old against some new.
Absolutely. I think that'd be really cool. So we can get some horror games on there as well. Both big fans of that. So I think that'd be really cool to check out. So make sure to check out Regeneration X. And of course, in regards to Hell in a Cell, let us know your predictions in the comments or submit your own at smacktalks.org/predictions. So all that's left to be said is enjoy Hell in a Cell. And until next time, catch you later.
Bye.